everyone. Welcome to Heliotropes. My name's Julia.
And my name's Kwadjo.
Thanks for joining us today. Before we get into our main topic, I just wanted to briefly talk about voting. This past week on June 9th was Georgia's primary, and if you've been paying attention to the news, you saw that it was a disaster. However, the news probably isn't sharing the full picture of it. Georgia takes its voter suppression very seriously and takes a lot of pride in it, which manifests in some really damaging outcomes for the state. And the reason that feels important to bring up is because a lot of politicians right now, and a lot of people in the country, with the police brutality and the protests and the demands for abolishing and defunding the police,
and the general election coming up,
are telling people to vote. Right, so they're saying when the general election comes around in November, vote. Like, that's how you make your voice heard, is you vote. And people actually think that's true, but it's not, because voter suppression is a very real thing, right? So voting is a tool to create change, or a tool to engage in the political process. But because of voter suppression and gerrymandering and all these other tactics, it is not the way that change happens the way that people like to think it does. And this, well, if everyone just goes and everyone has a vote, then that vote's counted, and then all those votes get added up, and then we get what the people want, right? Like, that's just not how any of it works. So I would really encourage you to check out information about voter suppression and ways that you can help end voter suppression.
Right. That message of vote to solve all your problems also fits into, like, you know, a theme of political reductionism, in the sense that people feel like their political, or rather there's been a lot of messaging over decades that kind of reduces everything you need to do, like, in order to participate in the political process, to voting, rather than, like, as you said, you know, voting being a single tool in a broad toolbox of different tools to use, you know, like contacting your congresspeople, contacting your representatives, calling them, sending them emails, you really even tweeting at them, things like that. Like being directly involved, going to town hall meetings, like there's all these different ways to go out and, you know, advocate for certain positions and lobby for certain positions and organize to gather support around certain positions and push those positions outside of voting. But a lot of people think that they really think of voting as the end all be all, you know, and it's just like, all I need to do is go to the ballot box and vote for one of these in the primary, any number of candidates, whether it's like one or nine candidates who, you know, like I've never heard of, and, you know, like I don't even want them to be in there, or I might not even know of, like I haven't done any research, right? But like, as long as you go in and cast your vote, you're doing your civic duty. And that's just not the way it is, you know. So yeah, I think that's a really important reminder to treat the vote as a tool, and to keep in mind that in order to respect the vote and, like, your capacity to do so, in order to actually make change out of it, there's a whole bunch of things you need to do outside of going to the ballot box, even just around voting.
Which is another way, right, around suppression too. It's not as if the state sends out a pamphlet of everyone running with their statement and their platform on it so that people are informed. And that's happened in different places where I've lived. And, you know, just to give you a couple of examples about what the voter suppression here looks like, it has looked like purging people from the voting rolls
without
notice, for no reason. It's looked like not mailing people their absentee ballots in time to drop them off. It has looked like machines not working. And just as an aside, the Georgia primary has been delayed twice now because of the pandemic. So there have been plenty of times to sort all these things out. It's looked like closing polling places, not having enough machines or people working at those machines, so the lines end up being hours long, not opening the polling place on time. And those are just some of the things. Those aren't even all of them.
And this is consistent. You know, like one of the things I go to, I mean, this time voting was nice. It was a breeze, you know. But in the 2000, you know, a lot of people associate voter suppression with the 2018, or sorry, with general election seasons, you know, the one every 4 years where you can also vote for the president. But, you know, 2018, when it was up between Stacey Abrams and Brian Kemp, I mean, voter suppression tactics were in full force, you know, and Brian Kemp was the Secretary of State there. His office oversees voting operations. And I went to vote, you know, in where I'm registered, and the line was 3 hours long. I mean, I got there at like 8 a.m. and I left at 11:30 or 12. I left at noon. You know, I was able to go in and like the line started moving at 11:30. Mm-hmm. Right. So there were people who were there before I got there who were waiting for as long as I was waiting. Right. And there were people who got there after I got there who were still waiting for hours. You know, I was waiting for like 3.5 hours just to vote. And all right. So that's
it's not a free and fair election.
Right. Exactly. You know, whereas there's, I mean, there's just no reason, you know, people will be, oh yeah, it's hard to coordinate these things. But like I tweeted or, you know, said something back then, it's, you know, if this is the cornerstone of your entire society is democracy and the right to vote, then it should be the thing that you get right, you know, mm-hmm. consistently. Except, you know, here in the South and a lot of places, like we saw with the Democratic primary between Democratic candidates up in like states like Minnesota and Wisconsin, mm-hmm. it's something we consistently get wrong.
Right. Iowa. There's lots of ways to get involved and to make change, and voting is one of those ways. So definitely vote, and also, you know, fight for everyone's right to vote and to have a free and fair election, and do other things to create change, because voting is not the thing to do.
And study. Study who you're voting for. Mm-hmm. Know who you're voting for. Yeah. Or who you're not voting for.
Yeah.
We're talking about policing today. We're going to explore what it means to defund the police, what police abolition is all about. I'm going to cover briefly a history of policing here in the United States. And, you know, talk about, address the issue of imagination that prevents people from, you know, really relinquishing this idealistic notion of the police that they have. I think this is something that's been pretty well publicized in the recent weeks, given everything that's happened, you know, the history of the policing and people talking about, oh, you know, like, the police started as, you know, in slavery, right? Started as slave patrols. Mm-hmm. And I think, I mean, while that's true, it also bears a little bit more elaboration, and it's also kind of tired, because I think it's relatively ineffective as an argument, because, you know, if you leave it there, then what you're expecting people to do is connect on their own the lines between history and the present. Mm. And, you know, if, like, you know, like, people or history, that is not something that most people do readily. So, you know, we're going to, like, draw some of those connections here real quick.
Yeah, if people could do that, then we likely wouldn't be having this conversation right now.
We wouldn't be having any number of conversations. Right. It would all be unnecessary because people would just know better. So instead of talking about the history of police, just like, you know, as far as the police themselves are concerned, which is something of a misnomer, I'm going to talk about the history of the laws in the United States, how that applies to people of color, African Americans, or African people as well, and the indigenous people. I'm going to talk about the notions of criminality, because those are two things that are intricately intertwined, connected with the police that don't always get a whole lot of, you know, attention. I'm going to plug real quick Michelle Alexander and Angela Davis, because, I mean, a lot of this information, it has been covered by both of them in, like, exhaustively over the years, and it's important to, with everyone who's in vogue right now, it's important to remember to bring them into your research material, into your studies, because, again, they've been talking about this stuff since before it was trendy, which is what it is today. So in order to really understand what the history of policing in the United States, and I'm starting in the South, as a whole, is one must understand the history of law, right? So we start in 1619, which is the year the first enslaved Africans were brought over from Angola, in Africa, to, you know, Virginia, some settlement, probably Jamestown. From 1619 to 1865, okay? In that time period, African people and their descendants here in the United States were considered and treated as legal property, okay? That means they had no personal rights whatsoever. And there was no expectation for them to be treated as people with rights, OK? okay? So keep in mind that over the course of this 150 years, I call it proto-policing because it wasn't policing again as we know it today, but it was easily like the prototype, right, for modern policing. Proto-policing in the South featured, you know, treating people as property, all right? Abusing them, hunting them, returning them to their owners, generally working against the agency of the people who were being enslaved. And just, you know, real quick note, it's important to note the correlation between the rise of that form of policing in the, you know, South, the American South, and the correlation to the rise of capitalism, right? As the bodies, the labor, the free labor of African people became more valuable in the sense that it was generating more profit, it became more and more incentivized to invest in having other people go out and maintain the system of slavery by keeping enslaved people from running away, right? So that's really important to keep in mind when you think about, because that connection still exists today, you know, the link between capitalism and policing. It just looks a little different, but I mean, we'll get more into that. Police formed in the South to control and protect white assets and interests in the form of African people. Those interests and assets were African people. And police in the West, so here's where we get into what this looks like outside, right? Because if you make the argument solely that policing came from slavery in the South, I mean, that limits, again, people's historical sense of things. But it's important to note that in the South, right, where slaves existed, or, you know, enslaved people were being enslaved, enslaved people were also enslaved, you know, Africans were also enslaved in New York, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Delaware, right? You think about Rhode Island being, I think it was one of two colonies where slavery was outlawed, which means there was slavery everywhere else, all right? And Rhode Island was one of them, and it's tiny. So these other, you know, colonies all had slavery, right? So one, it's inaccurate to, like, start with the South, or, you know, to focus solely on the South. We get into the North, and those same systems existed, right? Laws, again, all of this stuff was codified into law as far as laws that, I mean, there's property laws, laws around property, so the same laws and protecting property. The same laws existed in the North, and when you have those laws, the people who enforce those laws, I mean, that's law enforcement, right? So that's police. So policing in the South and in the North, those northern colonies, was oriented to a large extent nationally around protecting the, around, you know, oppressing African people in the United States. We go further west, and for you it's west. We go further west and we get into settler colonies, further frontier settlers, all right? And the big issue there becomes, you know, how do we protect ourselves from these indigenous people whose homes we're literally invading? You know, story of America, Manifest Destiny. It's what it's called, you know, but it's occupation and tyranny. So police organizations, proto-police-like organizations, they said the St. Louis Police Department was founded as one of, like, with the express purpose of defending the white population of settlers from indigenous people, right? So again, you have this trend in which it's the interest of an exclusive group of white people, whether it's the wealthy white landowners in the South or less wealthy, but you know, land-seeking and wealth-seeking white settler towns in the West, or, you know, in the Northeast, again, white settler towns and, like, slave-owning communities who are forming these police-type structures to defend their communities from, you know, the things that they perceived as threats. And this is super important because, again, it manifests today, right? Like, whereas today you can look back at that and say, oh, that's fucked up, you know, like, but
it's kind of amazing how that scales on so many different levels, right? Like, the idea of a group of people entering a space in a community that is not theirs to extract resources and to dominate it, and then claim victimization and require protection.
Right.
Right. That's like all of U.S. history.
Yeah.
In a couple of sentences, maybe.
Mm-hmm. All of it, even to this day, you know, like, and it's the same, right? Because right, you can't even take the thing and flip it on its head and be like, oh, okay, well, they can engage in like empathy exercises and understand that like it's Hippocratic to imagine today that those same people, or their descendants rather, that same ideology manifests in a group of people who are afraid of immigrants coming up into the United States and like taking their jobs or taking their land or whatever, right? Because now that they're here, they're like, oh, this is ours and we don't want anyone taking it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what if like a community of, anyway, any immigrant group came in and started establishing a police presence to protect themselves from, right? Like,
yeah, it's one of those pieces around, like, that I will address in a little bit, but around, like, violence begets violence, right? Because, like, if you go in and then you start protecting yourself and then that community tries to defend themselves, then, you know, right, it's like, see, like, they're being violent. We needed this protection the whole time.
Right.
And now they fulfilled every stereotype we had of them. And so we're going to make history on that. Like, that's going to be the narrative.
Right.
Yeah. Yeesh.
Yeah. It's messed up. So, you know, as far as laws and criminality, fugitive slave laws in 1793 and 1850 were nationally enforced. So, again, like, the phenomenon of police activity being intimately intertwined with slavery, the institution of slavery, is not just a Southern phenomenon, it's a national phenomenon. And then, I mean, so that's where we are. The laws were in place for enslaved Africans to remain enslaved Africans. And what that means, right, we have the law on one hand, what that means is that it becomes a crime for enslaved Africans to not be enslaved. All right, and you think about what that means in the South. Obviously, it means if you see a person of African descent somewhere in the South and they're not on a plantation, they're probably breaking the law just by existing outside of that plantation. And you know, the police enforce that. So you have a person who's just being in a place that is not where they're supposed to be, and they're breaking the law. And then you have the North, in which now it's a crime to potentially resemble someone who, right, it's the whole you fit the description, right? Because that's what they did. Fugitive slave laws. This enslaved person that, you know, some, you know, wannabe white master is looking for, right? This is their description, and you have the flyer, and you send it up to the North, and now, like, slave hunters, patrol people are walking the streets looking for that person. Oh, you fit the description. It doesn't even matter if they're the person, right? This is where this stuff started.
Motivated by money,
right. They're getting paid to go find someone, and then the person who is now missing, like, their property is willing to pay to go, you know, get that person in there. And that really correlates again to today, right? Like, and this is skipping way ahead, but prisons today, right? What is it? Like 8-10% of prisons today are privately owned, which means that they're for-profit entities, they're making money off of those, they're allowed to make money off of those prisoners. I mean, that's not even what it means. It just means that that's what they're doing. Profit, like, it's a company. The prison's a company. But it's something like 80% of, like, state-owned prisons, federally-owned prisons, are for-profit prisons anyway. You know, and that's a big thing. People are like, oh, yeah, 10%, that's not a whole lot. But, like, the majority of prisons are for-profit enterprises, which means someone, lots of someones, are making money off of the free labor of these people, which incentivizes the police to go out, and it incentivizes, really, police departments working in tandem with jails to go out and incarcerate people.
Mm-hmm.
It's fucked up. It's the profit motive behind all this. Angela Davis goes into, like, a lot of detail about a lot of this stuff in a lot of her lectures, and in Freedom is a Constant Struggle.
Mm-hmm.
Link it in the description for free to check out.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned the, percentage breakdown, because as you were saying, 8-10% are private prisons. I was like, that doesn't seem right.
Right.
But yeah, then yeah. the piece around like the for-profit prisons are yeah. really like all of the prisons yeah. almost, but that those are federally owned. And then, you know, like when politicians are like, well, we're going to end like private prison contracts. It's like, right. that doesn't mean that much unless you also end your own.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then also there's that crossover between, again, it's not just right. Cause you know, a majority of incarcerated peoples today are African-American. And I think the second largest by like number by volume is white people, which makes sense. But you know, they're still underrepresented in the prison system. And then people of Latino, Latinx descent. But right, the immigration detention facilities is a whole nother like realm of further criminalizing existing in the wrong place trends to this day in the form of immigration and immigration law. So we get into 1865 to 1964, right? A lot of people say, a big argument, people say is, oh, you know, like slavery ended, like get over it, blah, blah, blah. Things are better. Like y'all have your freedom, whatever. Jim Crow laws and black codes were enacted and enforced in the years following the emancipation of African people in 1865. One of the things they say, I forget, I think it was 1866 when the KKK was started, when it was founded. And it was just one of any number of vigilante groups who had taken it upon themselves to go out and terrorize these newly freed African people for being, right?
Especially after Reconstruction, and there right. was some like flourishing of, right, like black businesses and.
I would say especially, I mean, it's hard to say especially because I think during Reconstruction was the worst time, right? Because
right, like it was, a backlash.
Right, like to, it was a yeah. significant backlash. And then after Reconstruction, I think it subsided, but you know, the years of Reconstruction were so brief that, right, it's like the difference between the Holocaust and, you know, like transatlantic slave trade. You can look at the Holocaust and be like, wow, that's a lot of people killed in like only 5 years mm-hmm. versus the slave trade, which is a lot more people killed and enslaved over like hundreds of yeah. or 100 years. Whereas Reconstruction, that you're like, oh wow, that was like a lot of people. I think it was like 5,000 documented lynchings during the brief years. It was like a 10-year period, 12 years of Reconstruction versus post-Reconstruction to like 1960s mm. where right, the intensity of going out and of lynching was had diminished, but it only really diminished a little bit because yeah. that period's a lot longer. So like there's this combination of vigilanteism, right, which was bolstered by law enforcers and lawmakers, that's sheriffs specifically, going out and deputizing citizens, right? So you don't have to be a police officer to suddenly be on the police force. It's just like, oh, you know, the sheriff said, you know, I could go out and do this, so I'm going to do this. You know, can you imagine that today? Like, I can't actually. It's pretty terrifying.
Still happens. Yeah. They still make movies about it.
Right. Yeah. And then there's the lawmakers who either turn a, well, I'm going to say a blind eye, who look away from that stuff, from what's going on. They say, oh, we don't see it. Or they like explicitly endorse it, you know. And a big part of explicit endorsement was the laws that lawmakers made, you know. And that's where Jim Crow and the black codes come in. Just so you have an idea of the kind of, all right, because again, this idea of criminality is central to this argument. People will be like, oh, people, you know, like, you know, Daniel was telling me the other day that, like, you know, people are saying, like, George Floyd deserved it because he was a criminal. He had a criminal record. He had this and this, right? Criminal, 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 right? Forget Donald Trump and his literal, like, litany of lawsuits against him, and he's the president and receiving undying or unending adulation from a lot of these same people. But, like, the notion of criminality is, I mean, it's political and it's subjective, right? Whoever writes the laws and whoever enforces the laws, they're not removed from, they don't have some objective sense of what the law is, period, of right and wrong. So, some examples of laws that were enforced written and enforced in the Jim Crow era. Because again, if African people aren't enslaved, or rather, if they are enslaved, you don't need all these laws that cater to them as people. You just need laws that cater to them as property. Now that they have their freedom, suddenly we've got to like control this population. Vagrancy was punishable by, really, it's understood that all of these were punishable by death, because, right. I mean, that's just how it was. You know, death might not have been the only recourse, but it was,
right. There was no humanity.
Right. Yeah. So there were, a lot of people were either punished by death or sentenced to prison to like work in chain gangs. Again, like that's proto mass incarceration era. Vagrancy was a crime. Looking or talking to a white person inappropriately was a crime, literally punishable by death. Think Emmett Till, right? Mm-hmm. And also hearsay, right? Circumstantial evidence of doing these things, right? Because again, you know, in Emmett Till's case, mm-hmm. the woman who accused him on her deathbed was recused him. She said, actually, he didn't like do anything to me. Being unattended by a white person, all right, that was a crime. Looking for a better job, I'm paraphrasing that, but again, sharecropping was the dominant economic structure that took place after slavery, and a lot of these laws were oriented, all these laws were oriented around preserving the power that the former slave owners and landed wealthy had, right? And part of that included trapping formerly enslaved Africans on the properties where they were formerly enslaved. So literally there were laws around going out and looking for a better job. Mm-hmm. It criminalized that, right? So that became a criminal activity. Being out past curfew, right? Familiar things. These things were all criminal activities. So again, vagrancy, looking or talking to a white person inappropriately, being out past curfew, looking for a better job. And keep in mind that these things did not apply to white people. So there's an explicit double standard as well that's in play. And if you look at these things in action, what it looks like is just people of African descent in the United States being, right? Sitting on a corner, laughing with their friends, suddenly you're a criminal because some white person comes up and sees you doing some stuff that they think is untoward. And it's, you know, like, it's justified, like, in the law. And again, these parallels, right? The Karens who are doing their video things. Like, mm-hmm. it's crazy how closely these things line up.
The Karens and whatever the male counterpart is for that.
Right.
Because
this current era starts in 1965 with the Civil Rights Voting Rights Act. 1965. And this is where Michelle Alexander, like, really comes in. And I'm going to start with a quote from her. She said that what makes a community safe is not the number of guns, right, in that community, but the number of good schools, the number of good jobs, the number of educational opportunities, the numbers of opportunities people have for living a decent life, end quote. All right, so those are the things, right? Just think about that and share that with your friends, because again, a lot of people are having trouble understanding how communities can be safe without police presence. But we see it all the time in this country alone, right? And it's one of the things she does, again, you know, she's the author of The New Jim Crow, is that she goes into, okay, so she points out how the age of racial colorblindness, which is, that is to say, people are still clearly racist, but in the wake of the civil rights movement of the 1960s, 1950s, 1960s, it no longer became acceptable or tolerable to be overtly racist. So people had to, you know, express their racism in other coded, less subtle, more subtle ways. So in the age of racial colorblindness, legality, criminality, and policing have been mobilized to create a caste of modern disenfranchised minorities who are stripped of their rights as American citizens based on law. And if you have Netflix, access to Netflix, check out 13th. It's really good. So again, either read her book or watch that documentary. Both of them are amazing, you know, for this topic. And one of the, right, so like her argument there is that there's a racial caste that's formed by disenfranchising predominantly African-American men, all right? Because the 13th Amendment abolished slavery, all right? And the loophole in the 13th Amendment is that slavery is abolished here in the United States unless you've been imprisoned or, like, convicted of a crime, right? So it pretty much says you are not a slave unless you commit a crime and then we deem you to have that slave-like status, which again goes to this whole idea of private prison, for-profit prisons in general, right? Like, companies are making money off of the labor of American citizens here in the United States.
I'd also just like to insert there our beginning part about voting. People who are in prison cannot vote.
Right.
However, they count towards the population for representation purposes.
Right.
And so that's another callback to slavery.
Yeah. It definitely is. To the Three-Fifths Compromise, where Southern states, Southern politicians felt like they should have more power because, oh, we have all of these enslaved people here. But if our enslaved people don't count as full citizens, then, right, that was the argument of the North. You don't need that power. That power doesn't count because they don't count as citizens. So they came up with the Three-Fifths Compromise to say, okay, three-fifths, or each of your enslaved people counts as three-fifths of a person. Right, so the first steps towards personhood that enslaved Africans got in this country was for the sake of political expedience,
right.
Which is
for white people,
right? Powerful white people, which is absurd. But and like to that point, it's also important to note that in a lot of statistics, that's Valencia playing with a pen. For a lot of statistics, like the generation of these statistics, right, poverty statistics don't include prison personnel, right? They don't include inmates, right? If they did, these things would be completely skewed, right? Like, I think Michelle Alexander in, like, 2017 said something like, or 2012, 13, said something like, if Chicago included inmates in its imprisonment data, or, sorry, in poverty data, something like 80% of African-American men in Chicago would be unemployed, right? So just by leaving them out, right? So their status as prisoners, as incarcerated people, as felons, as any number of things, puts them in an area where it's deemed more acceptable to use them as you will, right? Like, even as far as data, you know, that's insane. Like, data. But, I mean, moving on. So, as Michelle Alexander notes, you know, the economic and educational disenfranchisement is really the thing that underpins this process. From that quote from earlier, if you give people economic opportunity, if you give people jobs, if you give people the ability to take care of themselves, right, and to grow their own institutions, then, and develop their communities, you won't see these crimes, right? And a lot of people come back, they're like, oh, like, if black people just stop selling drugs, if black people just stop killing each other, blah, blah, blah. As if, right, that's part of the whole pathologizing of blackness, is people looking at what's happening instead of looking at what caused what happened. And, you know, this is part of my whole thing on like, psychology, like, the 1920s and, like, you know, how it's been manipulated. Like, behavioral psychology is, like, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that those findings
mm-hmm.
were directly leveraged to facilitate the development of these kind of communities, right? Like,
right.
If you leave people in these conditions, right, you have the black box and you do whatever you do to the box to, like, manipulate the behavior and growth and development, psychological development of the mouse in the box, the worse the conditions are, the worse the developmental state of that mouse is going to be, right? They did the same things in developing ghettos. So that's an interesting thing. I'm going to hurry up because I know Julia has a lot to share as well. Alexander notes that the prison population has grown 5 times in the 30 years between 1975 and 2005. And that in part of that, right, a lot of people will be like, okay, yeah, that makes sense. There was so much crime in the 80s and the 90s. Crime rates studies show that crime rates and, research shows, crime rates and incarceration rates are independent of one another, right? So incarceration rates were going way up during this time, even as crime rates fluctuated. What that means is people aren't being arrested and incarcerated for doing more crime. It just means more people are being arrested, right? Presumably for doing less, right? The war on drugs was a major part of this increase, this ramping up, right? Enter Joe Biden, of more people being in jail. One of the things she says, more people are in jail for drugs today, and this was a few years ago, than all of the people who were in jail in the United States in 1980s, right? So like everyone who was in jail in the 1980s, and then today, everyone who's in jail for just drug offenses is a larger population. And then as far as the war on drugs, right? Richard Nixon coined the term war on drugs during his administration. And then Ronald Reagan, like, declared the war on drugs in 1982. And an important thing to keep in mind there is that he declared this war on drugs before the crack epidemic became a thing. And, you know, according to her research, while drug crimes were down in the United States, they were in decline already when he declared a war on drugs. And it cannot be understated that, like, the reason, the rationale behind the war of drugs and a huge fixture of our understanding, modern understanding of criminality, especially in black communities, comes from, like, the war of drugs, which was never a war on drugs for the sake of, like, reducing drug use. Right. It was always intimately connected to voting and to criminalizing a people who had just received freedom. And again, in the same way that, you know, Southern whites felt a backlash, you know, or not even felt, like, backlashed against freed Africans in 100 years ago, like, in 1865, during Reconstruction, that same energy from Southern whites in response to civil rights manifested, right? And it always comes down to this group of people who I've been taught my entire life are inferior to me are now, right, in 1865, it was now they're citizens just like I am. And that's going to compromise my opportunity to be the thing that I've been doing. And then in the 1960s, it was, oh, these people who clearly were still being taught that they were superior, right? Separate but equal was, you know, a facade. These people who have been taught that they were superior to this other group of people now have to contend in, like, job markets, in, you know, like, educate in schools, like, in every...
Well, in politics and voting, right?
Right.
Like, now.
Right.
Under the law.
Yeah. With, like, this group of people, and now they're like, oh, what do we do? You know, like, this is not cool. We need to do something about it. Someone needs to do something. And then enter Richard Nixon and his, like, court of advisors who implement the Southern strategy, which, if you don't know it, you should Google it or read about it. Michelle Alexander talks about it, and which was a strategy to win over the formerly Southern Democrats who felt disenfranchised by the advances that colored people had made in the civil rights movement, and decided to, I mean, it was essentially a strategy of associating, now that it was not cool to overtly recognize African people as inferior, a strategy of associating implicitly African people and crime, mm-hmm. All right? Boom. Which facilitated the war on drugs, which facilitated this further, you know, like, again, pathologization of African people born of what was essentially a white sense of inferiority. It's really weird how all of that works, but mm-hmm. I mean, I'm done for now.
I was reading something the other day about how the language changed over the different time periods in terms of being able, like, around the dog whistle politics idea, right? Like, at some point, like, the racial slurs were fine to refer to black people, right? Like, using the N-word. And then it became, like, this kind of different language and this kind of different language. And I forget where it was. It may have been in White Fragility. But it's interesting to see, like, the evolution of the language as you're talking about, right? As things shifted politically and in society around, like, what was overtly acceptable or not. Right. I also want to shout out White Rage by Carol Anderson also covers a lot of this stuff too. Yeah. And is an excellent read as well.
And we can, you know, a conversation that Julie and I have been having, this quick side note, about the kind of reading that a lot of white people specifically are doing in these times as far as being anti-racist and all. Like, yeah, it's cool if that book works, but people have been doing this kind of research and this kind of study for, again, as we said, a long time, right? So we're going to put these books in the links to buy them in the description. Check them out, right? White Rage, The New Jim Crow, what was the other? White Fragility, right? These are all, they're indispensable in understanding the system in a way that, like, you're not going to learn about just by reading a book about anti-racism.
When freedom is a constant struggle, or anything that Angela Davis has written.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to talk a little bit about defunding the police and what that means. And you didn't quite get to the now part of explaining everything that's happening. So we're going to assume that y'all have been watching the news to some extent and seeing the serious violence being perpetrated by the police against protesters, against black individuals, men, women, trans women. And that's where this call for defunding the police has come from. And there's this question around, like, does defund mean, like, what exactly does defund mean? And we're going to work on the premise that it means to abolish the police. That's how we are defining it, and that's how the folks who we've been looking to are defining it as well.
I would qualify that by saying as a step towards defunding, towards abolishing the police, right? Like, defunding doesn't equate to abolition,
right?
But it's in the direction, right? If you're going to abolition, you're going to hit defunding.
Yeah. We're not looking to just cut the police force in half and, you know, hope that that works out for the rest of our lives.
Not for practical purposes, but, like, ideally.
Yeah. So it's important to acknowledge first that the way that the police violence is currently being managed and considered is through a neoliberal lens, right, in which individual accountability is demanded and believed to be justice. So many people who consider themselves to be just and liberal, right, so, like, think about yourselves and your family and your friends. So those folks believe that the individual police officers who murder, assault, etc., whatever it may be, should be held accountable, and that through charging and punishing them in the current legal system, like, is how that process should be managed. However, right, like, that doesn't address the systemic issues that Kwadjo just outlined from 1619 to present day. And we know that that system allows and cultivates the behavior of these individual police officers, right? So, like, yes, people should be held accountable, but the idea that holding those people accountable is going to solve the problem, you know, just isn't it. Like, that's not a practical resolution for a system that has been working very well for hundreds of years. And there's plenty of information out there that police officers and the police union cover up and protect their brothers in blue, as they refer to themselves. Three most recent examples include the cop who murdered George Floyd had a history of excessive force and complaints, I think something like 17, and was still able to remain on the force. At least one of the officers who tased and pulled the two college students in Atlanta out of their cars was involved in the murder of Jamarian Robinson, who I think was shot at 70 some odd times by, like, a squad of officers while he was in his girlfriend's apartment.
I think it was 90 something times, and he was hit 76 times.
And the other example that we'll give is one of the officers who murdered Breonna Taylor, who was asleep in her home, was accused by two women of sexual assault. So there's a disturbingly high number of police officers who are rapists and sexual assaulters, in addition to 40% of the police officers who abuse their partners, right? So, like, take that information in. These abusers are the people who have guns, batons, tasers, who know the location of shelters, like safety shelters, and who know the laws inside and out. And they're backed by a union and this blue wall of support, right? There's all these people who know what has happened and who will not share information. And, you know, while we're on the topic of a police union, which we're not going to talk anymore about probably after this sentence, but AFL-CIO, if anybody has connections there, get your shit together and stop supporting the police union.
Dr. Joy Degree, I don't know how to say her name, but she's, she's a brilliant scholar on psychology and, you know, like racial history. And one of the things she noted, I was listening to one of her lectures the other day, is that in the same way that like a lot of child molesters and pedophiles are drawn towards careers in which they can gain access to children, mm-hmm. a lot of abusers, right, like sociopaths, not equating the two, but I'm saying, you know, abusers and sociopathic, you know, personalities are attracted to careers where they can have a disproportionate amount of power over other people's yes. autonomy. And that is, I mean, that's just a fact. So just be super mindful of that. Like, mm-hmm. if you're defending the entire institution of police, you're also, without question, then you're defending yes. these people's access to have this much power. And is that anything that we should, you know, mm-hmm. Aspire to in this kind of justice system?
Mm-hmm. There's about 35 states in this country, I think, where a prisoner or inmate can legally consent to sex with a police officer or corrections officer.
And, yeah. I mean, I read that in the sense that, like, it's... they don't even need consent.
Right, like, that's what I mean. Like, you know, as a therapist, I like having sex with a client is illegal and unethical because of the power differential.
Right.
Versus in this situation where someone can beat you and kill you with impunity,
right.
consent is actually recognized by law, right? As in, like, there's a whole system designed for people to get away with their sociopathic or abusive tendencies.
Right.
Yeah. So an argument that's come up quite a bit is that it's just a few bad apples, you know, like these bad cops that we see on these videos, it's just a few bad apples. And people forget, you know, the rest of the saying, which is the few bad apples spoil the entire barrel, right? And those folks are at the highest position. So we've talked about, you know, like the police officers who are, you know, like out on the streets. But it's also important to think about, you know, the mayors, the governors, the police chiefs, and they spoil the entire system. Also, let's consider how this is ironic for police and white people to be saying, given how they profile and enact racism and judge entire communities and groups of people based on their experiences with a couple of individuals, right? Those are the people who are saying, like, it's just a few bad apples. It's just a few of us. Like, don't judge us based on these few people while we're going to judge everybody else in the world based on, you know, a few people. When police are backed by their chiefs, union, and elected officials and the law, with the whole impunity business and it being more difficult to convict a police officer of murder because murdering is deemed part of their job, it's clearly not an individual problem and cannot be resolved by holding individual police accountable. Not to mention that individual police are rarely held accountable anyways for any of these actions that we're talking about or any of these like murders that go viral on social media. All right, so hopefully at this point, you know, y'all are in agreement that neoliberal individualism perpetuates systems and police brutality is a systemic issue. So let's talk about like what it looks like to abolish the police. Think a little bit about like what's your first reaction to defunding or abolishing the police? Like what feelings come up for you? What questions come up for you? You know, pay attention to what those are. Think about them. And wonder what parts of your identity inform those feelings and those questions. Does your racial identity inform your reaction to abolishing the police? Does your financial status inform your reaction and the questions that you might ask? So once you've thought a little bit about that, you know, ask yourself, have you ever called the police? And what's happened to you? Have you called the police, Kwadjo?
I mean, I've only for like traffic accidents, you know, because that's what they say you should do.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I've been thinking about that, and I realized, you know, like, have I been in a situation where I needed to call the police? And I think, you know, like, no, obviously not. Otherwise, I would have called them. But I have been in plenty of situations where other people would have probably called the police,
mm-hmm.
right? And I think that's an important thing to keep in mind, right? It, you know, it in the sense of imagination, you know, like a lot of people are like, yeah. oh, I'm just going to let, like even on a personal level, I could do any number of things in this situation, but I'm going to let the police handle it,
mm-hmm.
right? Instead of doing something to like engage. So yeah. no, short answers. I've only called the police in car accident situations.
Yeah.
And even in most of those, I wasn't the person who called the police.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've called the police once as an individual, and then I was thinking about this after, and a couple times at my job. And the reason I called as an individual, well, I called 911, I'm counting that as the police. I was driving to work in the really early hours, and like nothing was open, and a Burger King was on fire. And I was like, huh, is this one of those times like where I'm supposed to call the police? And I did, and they were like, yeah, we know.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. You know, like, I don't know what else to do. I can't put the fire out. And then at a job where I worked in a residential home, we used to have to call the police if we were getting physically attacked or assaulted.
Yeah.
And that's an interesting example that we'll talk a little bit about mm-hmm. later, because that goes back to what Kwadjo was saying about the conditions that ultimately, like, cultivate and create, right, like crime and desperation and need.
Right.
So I've also had a couple other like experiences with the police that I have not called the police but have gone with somebody to the police around sexual assault. And they were like, they weren't times where I was in danger, like we were going to the police station. And they were horrible experiences, like to the point where I would not recommend going to the police station to do that or going to see that officer or whatever it may be you're going alone. So think about that and if you've called the police and what those experiences were like and if you needed to call them or if someone else could have been useful in that time. And I would imagine that many people who are asking this question, you know, after we talk about like, well, let's abolish the police. And they're like, well, who do we call if like something, like if this thing happens? I would imagine that those folks have rarely called the police or live in communities that are like not police, meaning suburbs, which were created, right, like with wealth and distancing from what they perceive to be violent communities in mind and without taking any accountability for how they participated in the creation of that violence. But we don't need to go completely down there, maybe in the future.
Won't.
Okay, yeah.
yeah.
we yes, we need to.
Yeah.
yeah, that's a really good point. That needs to happen,
yeah.
and it will, but yeah. not in this one. The other like really important thing is that defunding the police is not a complicated issue, right? So like the ideas behind it are not complicated. I'm not gonna speak on it in depth to make it seem complicated because it's not. Defunding the police simply means to remove funding from the police and to take that funding, that chunk of money, and to fund community programming that can appropriately respond to people in need. And that might involve like the development and creation of new types of programming, but honestly, like people who have a ton of money do this shit all the time with their stocks, right? Like you take something out of a stock that's not working and you allocate it somewhere else, hoping that you'll have a better experience.
Yeah.
So that's what it means. The biggest issue with defunding the police, as Kwadjo mentioned before, is this poverty of imagination of what a world without police would look like. Because we have been indoctrinated with the idea that police, quote, protect and serve and catch all of these like supposed bad guys who are like running around who cause so much harm to us as individuals and to the country. And as Kwadjo mentioned, like the police protect and serve certain populations, and have defined who the quote bad people are, while, you know, abusing and murdering people and engaging in the same kind of behavior that they are arresting people for. We have been told, as a country and in different ways across racial lines and gender lines and different identities, to ignore how poverty, houselessness, lack of medical insurance, food insecurity, defunding education, lack of jobs, racism, and many other things adversely affect society and lead to crime, right? And we've also been told to ignore how police violence begets violence, which we talked a little bit about before, and which we have seen every single day, like on the news for the past 3 weeks, and in person if you've been out in the streets. Tear gassing protesters, pushing old people to the ground, murdering, you know, black unarmed men and women. And Kwadjo talked a little bit before about you know, like the origins of police and psychological, right? Like how psychology has also impacted our understanding of the world and why we feel like we need police. Another important piece to mention that fits into all of this is that police officers train for less than a year to do their job. And they have become the default responders to mental health crises, to violent conflict. They are in schools, they respond to robberies, they respond to sexual assaults, traffic incidents, noise complaints, murder investigations, foot patrols to intimidate and remind poor communities of color that the police are around, right? Like they do all of these things, and there's more, I'm sure. And the call to abolish the police asserts that the appropriate community funding would decrease many crimes, and asserts that there are more effective and less violent ways to manage the roles that the police currently hold. Like, do you really need a police officer to show up for a car accident, right? Like, yeah. In your experience? Or, like, to be in schools? Like, what the fuck is happening that police officers are in schools with weapons? Mm-hmm. Right? Like, black and brown kids who live in cities don't get any reprieve from police because they're in their neighborhoods, and then when they go to school, they're in their schools, right? And like, you know, empathy, like take a moment to think about how it would feel knowing what you know about the police and how violent they are, and seeing them, right, like in every moment of your life and feeling like you are a target and never feeling safe around the police and constantly feeling scared. And a place and your home where you're supposed to feel safe, and at school where you're supposed to feel safe, and where you're supposed to be learning to open these doors and like have different access to different opportunities. But the police are there. And people often say, what about rapists? Now, this is one of my favorite questions because it is one of the most absurd questions that people ask in response to, we can't abolish the police, like who's gonna catch all the rapists? Well, like, you know, check out our episode 9. I think that's when it was, right? You know, the rapists are walking the streets, and many of them are walking the streets in police uniforms. Right. So, not a good question. Now, considering like everything that we've shared, imagine a world where we had no police system, where there were a group of trained detectives to manage murder investigations who didn't necessarily, like, who weren't armored in, you know, like, with military garb, which we didn't even touch on, and don't have tanks that they're rolling in or grenade launchers, but, you know, a group of highly trained folks who have the appropriate, like, training in various disciplines and who have appropriate experience. Right, like they can manage murder investigations and other, you know, like intricate crime that they would need to, like, have specialized training in. And a world where we had community workers who responded to a traffic accident and documented the information for insurance purposes, because they don't even really, I mean, honestly, I don't understand. I've been in accidents, didn't call the police, and everything was fine. where we funded housing, where all people were well fed and had jobs and attended schools that had enough paper and pencils and books and resources, where we had healthcare for everybody, and where everyone made a living wage. Right? Imagine how that would impact an individual's psyche and their felt like life meaning, and how that could shift the entire dynamic of a family and a community. Where we had mental health workers who could respond to a mental health crisis and who could appropriately de-escalate situations. And this is, you know, this is something that's really important too. Like, people who are calling for defunding the police are also calling to replace cops with social workers. That's problematic. Many social workers act as agents of the state and as an arm of the police. Right, so like if you think about child protective services or some of the other roles that a lot of social workers are in, they are going into homes with the same ideas that you mentioned around like, right, like policing space and how it is to raise kids. And that's not to say that some of those kids aren't in really horrible conditions. And it goes back to the idea of why are those conditions the way that they are, right? So, and we also need to consider that social work and psychology, I mean, the fields of them are, you know, rooted in racism, as are, you know, all, as is all of academia. And so that's important to uproot. So the you know, goal isn't to just put social workers in all those positions, right? The idea is that the police does all these things that they're not actually trained to do, and putting the appropriately trained people in those positions is important, and to have those positions regulated. And again, funding those different community organizations rather than government organizations that are rotten at the root will create a different culture of caring, a different standard of living, and can ultimately shift the way that people see and care for each other. Now, I think this is particularly difficult for white people and maybe wealthy white people, and I suppose it could be particularly difficult for other groups of people. I should think about that. And the reason why is because like whites have never worried about their collective identity and communities because they've been perpetuating the violence and the laws and regulations, right? The systems were set up to protect white people, even at an individual level. And when I say haven't thought about like their collective identity, I mean, yeah, the Klan thinks about that, but like, it's not as if white people think about, oh, like all white people have to gather together, like to help each other and protect each other. That is not what it's about. It is like individualness, individuality, right? Like to the core. And so shifting to a community with interdependent principles, I think is like a really new concept for a lot of people, especially a lot of people with a lot of money, right? Because they're used to just being able to call on somebody to, you know, come and protect them, as opposed to having to put an effort to take care of themselves and their neighbor and the rest of their community. And so, right, like, it's not a complicated idea, even though it's a new idea. That's really important, too. Like, taking care of each other is not a complicated idea. I mean, like, really not at its core anyways. And the belief that every individual should have a life free of violence and a home and a living wage, food, safety, right? That's what abolishing the police is asking for. And, you know, like, I do think it would take time to enact. I also don't think it would take a decade to enact, right? Like, when we go back and talk about the people who have the power to do these things, the mayors have the power to defund the police, right? In Atlanta, Keisha Lance Bottoms could defund the police tomorrow if she wanted to, and they can call on their communities and create what works for them. So it could start happening really quickly if our elected officials believed in justice and freedom for everyone, and that's always where the caveat is. You know, and as Kwadjo mentioned before, there are a lot of people who have been doing this work for a long time, and we're not familiar with who all of them are either. But as long as we're on this planet with Angela Davis, check out her work about prison abolition, because police abolition, prison abolition, and legal system reform are all really tightly connected. Miriam Kaba. I don't know if I'm saying her name right. Also check out her work too. What she has spent all of her time doing is to abolish the prison industrial complex. And I'm certainly not endorsing the New York Times and all their bullshit, but she wrote a recent op-ed in there, and it's definitely worth a read for a place to start around like if prison abolition is new or if you have questions about it or are thinking about it. That's a great place to start, and then following up on more of her work.
Before we finish, I just want to touch on a few real quick things. In preparation, and really over the years, some of these I revisited, never familiar, I'd seen them before, but in preparation for this episode, one of the things I did was go through, you know, TED Talks, TEDx Talks, and listen to police officers to kind of get an idea of what police officers are saying. And I think, you know, for the most part, it's very predictable, but there was one really, I think, profoundly disappointing strain. I mean, it was half disappointing, half very validating, that, you know, pervades a lot of them, if not all of them. You know, I summarized four, listened to more than that. And in all of these talks, right, essentially what it comes down to, like the thing that's validating, right, because a lot of people, again, they will run to defend the police as if, you know, police haven't been pointing out problems in their own institutions, in their own departments for however long. But here you have a list of police officers, right? If it's worth the time to you, I'm not going to say it is, but if it is worth the time, go and listen to those things as well. But make sure you listen to, like, everyone else we just mentioned first. but police TED Talks really come down to police officers pointing out really poignant problems in the way that they operate as a whole and or in their own institutions, right? One of the ones is a police officer who's like, yo, I'm off duty and I just worked a 16-hour day and, you know, like, I'm going to go home and then, like, I see the car in front of me swerving and I'm like, oh, what do? I could just go turn right and go home, or I could turn left and, like, follow them and, you know, do my policing. So he goes and does his policing. Again, he's off duty. He worked 16 hours, and you're like, where is this going to go? But it's a TED Talk, so of course it's positive. He goes and he, like, stops the person in front of him, and he sees it's like a 17-year-old African-American male who's texting and driving. And, like, I mean, long story short, this officer looks at the kid, and he's like, that kid clearly thought that I was going to kill him. And the moral of his story is, we need to remember the humanity in the people that we're working with, right? Like, I saw a look in his eyes that I saw in my son, right? So that's one of those stories where you listen to it and you're like, oh man, like, this is so endearing. But also, the drama from that story comes from the fact that that kid thought that he was going to get, and right, like, that's one of the things. I've seldom called the police for anything outside of, at all, right? And it's always in that same context of a car accident. And I'm always hoping that, like, the person who's also involved in the car accident, like, just that situation is going to help, you know, as long as, you know, all my stuff is clear. Anyway, the point is, I've been on the other side, though. Like, people have called the police on me, and those have been terrifying encounters for no reason. And it's really frustrating to think about. But, like, I mean, that's one of those things, right? So he makes that appeal. He's like, oh my, like, clearly we've forgotten our humanity, so we need to remember that. And then, you know, that talk doesn't do anything. And then someone else comes in and they're like, oh, you know, like, quote, 90 to 95% of our training deals with 5 to 10% of our job, right? And he's talking in this talk about, like, the warrior mindset versus this sense of guardianship. And which, right, like, if it's one or the other, like, I get it. You should be, like, guarding, I guess, being a guardian, more of a guardian than a warrior in your neighborhood. But, like, you should really just be a person who's, anyway. And then, like, another officer who's talking about his own experience as a black man running down the street. You know, he's a cross-country runner. He's going for an 8-mile run. And then, like, in mile 6, the police come up to him and they say, hey, like, what are you doing around here? He's like, I'm just jogging. And then they're like, you weren't part of this robbery that just happened with this old lady. And like, obviously he's not going to say it. So they kidnap him, take him to the house of the old lady, put him in front of the old lady. And you, I guess it doesn't really matter like what their race is. And the old ladies, they're like, yo, is this the guy? And the old lady squints. And he says at that moment, he was like, I'm going to jail, right? Because they're leaving this up to this old lady who can clearly barely see. And she's like, no, that's not him. And then they let him go, right? They didn't say anything to him. They just like dropped him back off at the spot and let him go. And he was talking about how mad and enraged he was and how he cried for the rest of those 2 miles. And then he became a police officer 11 years later and was in it for like another 20 years and had to like see, you know, he was like, yeah, we need more emotional intelligence training and blah, blah, blah. So again, like systemic issues and like distilled into a story that makes for a good TED Talk. And then like one of the last ones that I watched was something about like a dude who's working in Kansas City describing textbook cases of how he thought that over-policing his neighborhood and over-ticketing, over-incarcerating, like abusing people was going to do good to like turn that neighborhood around. And it just like increased the distance dramatically between the police officers and the neighborhood. So they decided to start.
Obviously.
Yeah. But like, you know, like institution of police. I think that's one of the things, that's one of the, like the underpinnings in this particular case is it should be obvious that that's not going to work. The guy who promoted, who was pulled over, who was harassed, who was running and kidnapped by the police and then returned, he pointed out a statistic that I thought was really interesting and I didn't corroborate it, but I mean, it sounds legit. He said USA Today reported in 2017 that 46 police officers nationally were fatally shot. 140 police officers in that same year died by suicide, right? So when police officers talk about their jobs being the most dangerous jobs, it does not even, literally 3 times as many police officers take their own lives as police officers whose lives are taken in the line of duty. I'm just gonna leave that there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole piece that we can go into about mental health.
Right.
And that's part of, right, like police officers not being trained for their jobs, right, experiencing trauma. And then because of this whole system that's set up, which is this like hyper masculine, like we don't acknowledge when anything's wrong or when we're fucking up or when we're hurting people or that violence is like traumatizing to us, right? That gets in the way then of seeking mental health. Now imagine if those police officers weren't in those positions and people who were trained, oh, I don't know, maybe for more than 8 months around mental health and knew how to manage those situations and de-escalate and deal with secondhand trauma, right? And like do all of those things could be supported. And it also goes to show too, I mean, that's not a new phenomenon, right? That just happened in 2017 and that was it. But it also goes to show about how the police union doesn't actually protect the police, like the individual police officers. Right. So if you are about individual police officers, right, they're also not being protected.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Were, for the people, the officers giving the TED Talks, were they in their uniform with guns?
I honestly didn't look for guns, but yeah, I mean, they were definitely in their uniforms.
Yeah, yeah. Of course they were, because that's how they show up, even at community events.
Right.
Yeah. Also, a great way for them to acknowledge their humanity is to quit their jobs and do something else.
Yeah. See y'all next week.
Bye.
Bye.